Today is September 22nd, 2015, and we're here in Highlands Ranch to do an oral history with Art Cook. Welcome, Art.
Thank you, Donna. Enjoy being back in Colorado, especially Highlands Ranch.
That's wonderful. So let's talk a little bit about you first. Where were you raised?
I was born in Fargo, North Dakota, and within about a year or so, I moved to where became my hometown, La Crosse, Wisconsin. As La Crosse, Wisconsin, I was one of five boys, the oldest of five boys. Lived nine blocks from the Mississippi River. Went to school there, elementary school, went to Aquinas High School. And my first year of college, I went to the University of Wisconsin, and then transferred to an all-boys school in Dubuque, Iowa, Loras College, L-O-R-A-S, often confused with Lawrence in Wisconsin, northern Wisconsin. Wherever there's an all-boys school, it seems you'll find an all-girls school. And there was. There was Clark College University, which is where my wife went to school. And we met, we kid each other, I do anyway, about a backstage romance. We were both in a drama class. She has a beautiful voice and had the lead in Rodgers and Hammerstein's Showboat production. I was in that show as the sheriff, and I exposed the miscegenation case on board the Mississippi Riverboat. And as it came into existence, I also kid her about the fact that she was the star of it, and of course I had a big print name, but my name appeared twice in the program, once as the sheriff and once as the waiter in the ballroom scene. But it was great. Okay. We graduated from college from there.
So what did you do after you graduated from University of Wisconsin?
Well, I graduated from Loras. Went to my first year was at the University of Wisconsin, and went to Loras. And after graduating from there, back then they still had the draft that existed. And of course, I was very eligible for the draft. And I thought there might be another better way to do this. And so, the services would provide recruiters to talk about their officers' candidate programs to the college students. And I did one of those things with the Navy and was selected to enter Officer's Candidate School. Went to Rhode Island, Newport, Rhode Island, for a four-month training. And that was right, I had 2 months out of after graduation. In September, October, November, and December, those 4 months, I was in Newport, Rhode Island. Received the commission. And returned back to the Midwest on the 27th of December. We were married and had to go right away to my first duty station, which was then, I had a three-year commitment to Supply Corps School, which was in Athens, Georgia, where I was 6 months, and then got my first real assignment to the West Coast. I recall vividly, they would say, "Well, now you folks are officers, and where would you like to go, to the Mediterranean or to the west coast of the Orient?" Well, as I mentioned earlier, when I was in La Crosse, I went to too many Saturday matinees with Roy Rogers, Gene Autry, Hopalong Cassidy, all those programs. I wanted to go west. I just wanted to see these places where they filmed these movies. And I ended up selecting the west coast. Got a very fortunate billet out of Long Beach, California, Southern California. Got on board a ship, which was there only 2 months, and we set sail to go to Bremerton, Washington, where we decommissioned that ship and recommissioned the USS Delta, a repair ship, AR-9. Came back down just in time for Christmas holidays. And I got to see my firstborn son. I was 2 days old before I knew he was born. They didn't have the communication systems like they have nowadays. But that was about our son, Arthur Stevens Cook, third, actually. And the grandson, which is the fourth. So they like the legacy to continue, I guess. I'm surprised, but I enjoy it.
So you talked about your first son. Tell us a little bit more about your family.
Well, I've got a wonderful wife, Patricia. She was from Davenport, Iowa, and as I mentioned earlier, went to college in Clark College in Dubuque, Iowa, as we did, I did. We were married then, went to, drove, right, we left the wedding, we were on our honeymoon. Our honeymoon was in Peoria, Illinois, en route, as I said, to Athens, Georgia, for my first duty station. Right away, we found out that we were going to have a baby, and the first of five, five children, the four boys and one girl, and Marie was number four. We had Stephen, Mike, Tom, Marie, and Christopher. Four of those five live in Southern California within 45 minutes of us. A couple of them in Vista, California, and San Clemente, and Anaheim Hills. And the fourth one, our youngest son, who was here with us when we came to Colorado, the three youngest ones came with us, the two older ones stayed there. But she was, Marie was our daughter. Pat loved that. Of course, I have a daughter, as you can imagine. They all were fortunate enough to go on to school as well, and our blessing is a very happy, happy family. We enjoy the occasions we get together. As our youngest son, as I mentioned, is Christopher, and he elected to live and come back to Colorado, where he went through junior high and high school. And so it was a great opportunity for us, because now when we come back to Colorado, well, we get that wonderful invitation to stay at their home, enjoy their meals, and use their extra vehicle. And so just a very blessed family that we're so thankful for.
That's wonderful. So while you were in California, how did it come about that you were hired by Mission Viejo Company?
Well, I don't know if I'll tell the story very accurately, because it's told many ways, I think, by many people. I lived in, as I mentioned, in Bellflower, which was near Long Beach, and that's, I'd commute to Long Beach. After I got out, I worked for North American Aviation, it was at the time, became North American Rockwell, and then Rockwell Corporation. I worked for them for 11 years, and in a contract administration, pricing and proposals function for their research division. A very fun job. That's why I stayed for 11 years. It was during that period of time, probably in the 60s, early 60s, when the family was now five children and we were living in a three-bedroom home. It was our first home. It was a new home when we were there, but small. So it was time for us to look for a larger location with the five children. And there was this new community in South Orange County called Mission Viejo. And we thought, well, let's go down and take a look at it. It'll be a little longer drive to get back and forth to work and everything, but we were hearing about this new community, how it was starting to be a real place to young families to move to, etc. So we went down to Mission Viejo and found a home for us. You know, back then our first home was only $18,400, the three-bedroom home. Well, it was almost double that, because our big five-bedroom home in Mission Viejo was now $32,000. Oh my, what, we figured we'd make the payments and get by. Fortunately, we had a new recreation center that was being built in the southern part of Mission Viejo where we lived, and it was going to have a swimming pool. Pat was very active in swimming in high school. She was a lifeguard, and she wanted to make sure that our children were introduced to swimming as well. Well, when we were, they got on the swim team, it was the Mission Viejo Nadadores. The Nadadores is now a national team, and it was, had Olympians, Brian Goodell, Shirley Babishoff. But when we were in the novice swim team, we would go up to all the swim meets, because we had so many children, and they were there morning, afternoons, age groups, and Saturdays and Sundays, age groups, morning and afternoons again. So we got to know a lot of people. And we became active, of course, in the swim team. I was always one of the timers there. And I remember this one particular day when I was on lane one, timing. And the announcer stand would be on a banquet table there to the right side of lane one, and it was an 8-lane pool. And the announcer we knew each other, Jim Teffer, and that's the story that jumped to how I became employed with Missionero. But he asked me, he said, Art, he said, I've got to make a restroom call. Could you just come over and do a couple of starts for me? So I've not been shy of a microphone, as people have become aware. So I said, sure, Jim, fine, I'll go over. And I sat at the desk while he made his call, and I enjoyed it. I think I added a little more flair to the starts and the winners and the completions and the times and best times for so-and-so. So I enjoyed it. I had a fun time. And now the way that he tells the story, he came back and wanted to take over the microphone again and continue his duties. I never let him in again. It just went on and on. And somehow we never tell him where the swim meet was, except his daughters, two great daughters. Were there, and they would ever swimming, and so we just had a fun time, actually. But I continued doing the announcing as the swim team was growing. They already had two pools competitive. One was a 6-lane competitive 25-yard pool, and the one we were in was the 8-lane competitive pool. And we thought, you know, wouldn't it be great? We've got a good team here. It's developing into a good team. And if we could, let's put together a group of the Booster Club. I was then president of the Booster Club and others that we knew in the community. So let's put together a proposal for an Olympic, a meter pool, where a real competition could take place. Now, it was a very novice proposal, but we submitted to the company, and I think the company really, they accepted it with open arms, unbeknownst to us. They wanted the support from the community. The Missionero Company was very good about that. So they accepted our proposal to build a pool, and that's where our Olympians came of age. It had a diving tank, and it continues to this day to be a very competitive team pool. The city of Mission Viejo has just recently authorized funds to continue its maintenance and improvements on it, and they do a very good job.
Great. Well, how did you become employed by Mission Viejo Company?
Well, after I got more aware of the company, and I was with what was the Mission Viejo Activities Committee. And that was much like here in Highlands Ranch, the Highlands Ranch Activities Committee, which we started because we knew the benefits. And we started that activity, the Activities Committee we were involved in. My wife, again, was very much involved with it. And we did the Santa's Arrival programs that were introduced then to Highlands Ranch as well. And I became eventually the president of the Activities Committee and got more involved in the community. And we would do many events that we introduced here in Highlands Ranch as well. The Easter egg hunts, the pancake breakfasts, the Mission Viejo days, Highlands Ranch days. Programs of that nature we did. And I just kind of became a voice in the community, I guess, the microphone. And as the community was growing, the gentleman there was with the Community Relations Department, Marty Russo, great guy. He needed additional help. And so the company looked, said, okay, Marty, get some additional help. They did interviewing, and I was fortunate enough to get the job. And consequently, I was in the Community Services, Community Relations Department in Mission Viejo, California.
Wonderful. Did you have any connection with the Aurora development by Mission Viejo Company?
Oh, yes, briefly. I want to explain it a little more. Aurora was a program, is a program in Colorado. It's 1 square mile, and we developed a community, built homes there. I guess if you're talking like Highlands Ranch Missionero Company, in California it was 11,000 acres. In Colorado it's 22,000 acres for Highlands Ranch. Another project in Aliso Viejo, just across the freeway from Missionero, is Aliso Viejo. That's 6,600 acres. And so when we came to Colorado, we did a square mile, 640 acres. But the pattern was the same. We did quasi Mission Viejo, California's design style for homes, but certainly to the winter temperature air, to withstand the winter temperatures and everything. But it had the recreation centers and functions of that nature. When the recreation center in Aurora opened, they said, we want to put on a steak barbecue dinner for everybody. Invite them down to the community and see the new recreation center. And so they asked Pat and myself to come over and put on this dinner for them, this picnic barbecue for them. And I said, sure, that'd be fun. So we came over to Colorado, and in Aurora, we set up the tables and the napkins and the tablecloths and the barbecues, everything, and ready to go. And unbeknownst to us Southern Californians, in Colorado at 4 o'clock, you look to the west and you see clouds coming across, and we looked, and sure enough, the rainstorm came at 4 o'clock, and all our tablecloths had to be changed and everything. But they asked me to come over at that time to do that type of a program for Aurora and talk to the folks about the community, the importance of community activities. I might add at this point that they now have a very active homeowners association, and I got to know their past president and invited him to come over to Mission Viejo to see the sister community. And his family took a vacation to Southern California. They stopped by. I gave them a tour of the community, and not surprising, I guess, we didn't even get it finished, but we did the rec centers, the lakes, and the community parks and activity committees. Of course, it was a city by that time, but I still get the email with the letters from them, monthly letters of their association. So that was my introduction to the Colorado program.
Okay. So you were still employed in California by Mission Viejo Company. How did you come to Highlands Range in Colorado?
Well, I got this call from Jim Teffer. And he was in February. And he says, hi, Art. And I says, hi, Jim. And he says, I'd like you to come to Colorado. Well, you know, I'd been there, as I just mentioned, for the activity program. I thought, oh, good, I'm going to get to do another little trip over there and have fun putting on some kind of a program. And, of course, by that time, he had been here a year because they had done the development plan for Highlands Ranch. They'd bought the ranch, and they'd spent a fantastic year with his planners going over the development plan. They finished it, and they were excited about it. And he called me and said, I want you to come over to Colorado. Well, sure, Jim, when? I was thinking again for another weekend type thing, maybe. And I said, sure. Well, what do you want? What do we need? No, I want you to move over here. Oh, my. Okay. let me think about that. For how long is that thing? And I said, oh, well, okay. I said, let me talk to Pat and everything and make sure that I'm making my... what am I going to do over there? Well, you've got to... we need somebody over here that's not shy, who will be able to talk... we're introducing the program now, the development plan, through the numerous jurisdictions. It's going to go through the county, through state agencies, through districts and everything like that. And we also need, we've got the planners that do that, but we need someone to talk to folks who are just interested in the community, interested in what's going to happen. Because once it hits the jurisdictions, then it goes public and people are going to say, what in the world are you going to do? You know, don't Californicate Colorado was the way that they wanted to make sure it didn't happen. So they wanted someone to come over to take the exhibits, the pre-development plan, and describe what was going to happen on this fantastic property of Highlands Ranch.
So you were phoned by Jim Teffer, called you, and wants you to move there.
Well,
not
I did.
Not to come visit, but move.
Not to participate in an Aurora program again and go back. It was relocate to Colorado. This was in February. Now, I thought, oh, what am I going to do, Jim? Well, we need someone to present the plan to the public. We've got the organizations. We've got the technical people to present it to the jurisdictional groups and everything that have to give the approvals. But so I said, well, I don't know. Let me talk to my wife and make sure we know what we're doing. And we came back. She said, sure, Art, that's the way it goes. I'm willing to go with you. But she waited. I went out in February with Joe Lambert, the two of us. And she came out with the family, and we found a place in Littleton, because it was prior to Highlands Ranch, of course. And we had the children come out, of course. Three of the five children, the two had already graduated from high school, and they stayed in Southern California. And the other three came and attended schools in junior high in Littleton, and then went on to Littleton High School. Those school districts are very good to our family. I mentioned because the swimming earlier, the two boys got swimming scholarships, one to the University of Houston, the other to the University of Kansas. Very good for, thank you, folks. And we then ended up making the move, as I say, found our place. And another feature is that, well, I wanted to talk about going to see all these organizations and groups. I would fly back periodically, once a month or so, just to see the family. And I came back and one Sunday night and was ready to go Monday morning. Monday morning, what I did is I had five presentations to do in 2 days. Monday morning at 6:30, I was down in Parker giving it to the, with my big exhibit board, giving it to the Parker Breakfast Club. At noon, I was downtown Denver in the 11th story of one of their business buildings talking to financial people. In that evening, I was at the Friends of the Library in Littleton talking to them. The next noon, I was in Arapahoe there, kind of talking to the Rotarian Club, and that evening somewhere else, I forget, but we just, that's how interested people were in wanting to know what's happening out there south of County Line Road in Douglas County. And my presentation was general enough to where it wasn't technical. As I say, that was the planner's position to do. And I would answer questions. They were generally easy enough for me to answer, but they talked about how many people, how big, what type of housing, and that type of thing. So they were general enough for me to answer.
Mm-hmm. So the people were very interested in what was going on there, because it was just wide open spaces. There wasn't anything out there, so they were concerned.
They had a genuine interest. Remember, County Line Road separated Arapahoe and Douglas County. And right across the north side of Arapahoe Road is the city of Littleton, and it was just they wanted to know. So it just wasn't, I wasn't talking to people in Highlands Ranch. There weren't any.
Yeah,
but it was, and I'm trying to recall. I think at that time there was only one incorporated city in Douglas County. Someone mentioned to me that possibly Lakeview Lakeside, down in the south west corner, there was an undeveloped community of about 600 people, they thought, and they said it might have been incorporated, but otherwise it was just Castle Rock. Parker was not incorporated, any of the other areas, and so we were going to be a large community. Mm-hmm. And to this day, it's interesting, with 100,000 people, it is still an unincorporated community. I attribute that to the fact that the Michelin Company did a community plan. They planned, that's the secret, as I've said, they planned the entire 22,000 acres, the development plan. It showed where the residential was going to be. It had the colored tones showing upper higher densities, lower densities. It showed the residential commercial areas. It showed the industrial areas. And of course, the green space. And that was a feature that 60% of the 22,000 acres was undeveloped area and was going to be left as an open space area. The far southern part of the community, which you don't see up here at all, is more rolling, undulating hills, majestic ponderosa pines, scrub oak. It's totally different than the northern portion. And we left that. We didn't need that. We just did the development activity in the northern part. Folks in Highlands Ranch are familiar with the Highlands Ranch Parkway, which is the circular main, I would say, route to, in the central part of the community. The plan was so well done. And it was done initially, the entire plan, in the beginning. And it wasn't, it differs itself from subdivision work. People had seen subdivision work in a small building here, a small part there. And the roads come later, you know. Well, here we did the roads patterned in the beginning, in the open space areas, everything in the density plans. That's the secret of the success of Highlands Ranch, Mission Viejo, Elisa Viejo.
Not being afraid to communicate information shows that they have a lot of confidence in their development, and the people, I think, appreciated that fact that they had confidence in it and gave them confidence that it would be a great place to live.
Absolutely, Donna, absolutely. I enjoyed going out and talking to these groups, knowing that some of them might be confrontations, but still, the questions were not the technical types. They were the general questions, and those I had a general understanding of and was able to relate to. One occasion, do I recall, and I would go over the presentation, I'd go to a particular group, to Jim Teffer and a couple of the planners in the company, and they said, well, we're just getting ready to introduce a new home program, and it's going to be over this western side. And they said, and I said, okay, how big a program is it? Well, the homes were going to be $217,000, I think, back then. And I thought, well, that's, but don't tell anybody that. Well, you know what happened? It slipped out. He never let me forget it. It made no difference to the folks. They didn't know what it was, but it's our fun bashing back and forth.
So the first residents moved in the fall of 1981. And how did you welcome them? How many were there?
Oh, it was right there off Broadway. And you're right, it was the fall of 81, October, November, I think they came in. And what we did is, but you know, let's start communicating with the residents. These are the folks that are going to make the success of this community. So four of us dressed up for Thanksgiving. The three of them as pilgrims, and of course me as the turkey. And we distributed, I think it was 35 turkeys to the new families that were living in Highlands Ranch, just as a welcome to them as the initial residents. Thank you, and we hope you're going to have a wonderful time. Yeah. The initial resident still lives in Highlands Ranch. It's amazing.
I bet they were very surprised.
Yeah.
And then after Thanksgiving came other family-type holidays, and how did Mission then incorporate the residents?
We really wanted to, you know, the success, I believe, was communicating and getting the residents involved in activities. You could publicize this new town of Highlands Ranch in the newspapers or on the radio ad or signboards or things like that. But the best way I found, and I believe in, was through the residents. The residents will come if they enjoy the community, if they enjoy the activities. They go back to work the next day. They go to the bridge club. They go to their activities, their schools, and they talk about the activity that they did that weekend, what they did, who their friends were, what they're meeting, what's going on. That was the basic success for getting Highlands Ranch on the map, getting them known to what's happening in the community. Well, what we did then was extended that first little activity that I just related about Thanksgiving, and we were going to establish an activities committee of the residents, the HRAC, Highlands Ranch Activities Committee. And they would be the residents themselves planning their events and carrying them out. So we got notification to all the new residents, said, we're going to have a meeting of the residents and talk about what we're going to do as fun times here in this new town. And what was that? It was the introduction to Highlands Ranch Activities Committee. And right away comes the first holiday event, which was Christmas time. And so we did, I patterned it after California because it was successful there. I said, let's have Santa's arrival. And all the kids come down and greet Santa and talk to Santa and make their wishes known. And we had Santa located. I called back to California. I said, folks, send me a picture of Santa's workshop. The red and white Santa's workshop with the white picket fences along it and everything. We're going to have a Santa and we're going to have him come in and talk to the kids. And they sent the picture. I sent it right over to a little construction group people. Said, please get this made so we can have it by the middle of December. And that weekend in the middle. And they said, well, okay, we'll do it. And we had a publication. I forget what it was. It wasn't the Highlands Ranch Herald yet, I don't believe, at that time, which was our normal eventual community information document. But we got information flyers of some type to everybody in the community, and we would get the kids to distribute them with their parents. And they then came down to there on Broadway, which is south of 470 and Dad Clark Drive and that place. And it was just on the mountainside there, that little where the Mobile Homes turnout is, I believe, today. I've been gone 27 years, so sometimes my memory is. But they put up this workshop with the picket fences and some decorated trees and invited them all to come down to see Santa. That was our first activity. The community was so responsive to the events and activities that they came down. And then what happened? Sure enough, the next Monday they went back to work, and the mothers went to their bridge clubs and features and everything, talked about what the kids have, the wonderful time in Highlands Ranch. And it worked just fine again. So we had already formed the activities committee now and had a successful event. So we gathered again in late January and said, well, now what are some of the other events that we're going to put? Let's think a little broader for the whole year. Put on some functions over the entire year. And we sat down and we talked about plans, which developed then. The pancake breakfast, we had those. And we had the 4th of July, Easter egg hunt, pancake breakfast, was that, I guess it was. And we had the 4th of July activity. And we had the Highlands Ranch days. And those were all seasonal things that worked just right for the year. And it was Santa's arrival time again in December. So they were all enthused about it, and that made everything so much easier. Each event would have a chairman from the committee. So it would be guys or gal who would be chairperson of that event. And they just got so involved, and they brought people in, and that helped. Plus the fact that we'd always encourage people who attended the events to come up and join this committee who puts these events on. We have fun, and it just worked. And once it worked, the community worked, and that's how it got spread. And that's what made, come back to the fact, Highlands Ranch known and a place to come and see our new model homes opening and what happens. And it just worked wonderful.
And the every people, year,
it continued.
It grew and grew.
It grew and grew every year. Well, our events became more successful. More people attended them, and we'd have our meetings before the committee would meet, and they'd come up with the ideas. They had maybe had this down in Lamar, a little function down there when they lived there, done that. And they would come up and they'd introduce what they wanted to do. It was great. We had cooking events and hot dog event programs, and they just introduced one after the other.
That's great.
I wanted to mention, again, I've never mentioned this before, this was before the even it happened, right after the Christmas program. We had where the kids get in these carts, go-karts, is it? I don't know. But the parents make them, and we took this hill from where's the metro district? It comes down that hill there over to where it used to be Bishop's office. Mm-hmm. And we had the kids all lined up. The parents, then we had about 15 people with kids with carts, and they
soapbox derby
is exactly what we did. We had over 20 of them, and we did them by age group, and that was another initial community event. I don't think we staged it again later, but it was one of those get them going, and it just worked because it was family. It was kids involved. Kids are family, no question about it, you know. And that was our focus, that was our direction. But I haven't spoken of that since the day it probably happened. And I'm driving over here this morning, I thought, let's mention Soapbox Derby. And thank you, it was fun.
Well, not only did you coordinate a lot of the activities going on, but you were also the ranch manager, which probably took a little bit of time. And as a ranch manager, what did you do?
Well, the ranch manager, Highlands Ranch, 22,000 acre. It's got fantastic history over the years. You've never been to the mansion, make sure you go down and see it. They've got the Metro District has done a fantastic program in making improvements to the mansion. Make sure you go down and see it. It's open, it's free, and tours given Tuesdays and Thursdays, I understand. And they've got fantastic displays and a great pictorial history of Highlands Ranch dating way back. And we get going on that, and I forget where I was heading.
As a ranch manager.
Oh, ranch manager. So we came along, and the ranch it's two different parcels, really. The northern part is the rolling grazing grasslands. You get down into the southern part, which we left as the undeveloped area, and it's more undulating and majestic ponderosa pines. Down there was also the Arapaho Hunt Club was located down there, and they had their kennels and stables down there, and a couple of little resident areas for the huntsmen and huntmasters, and also down there, I'll mention before I forget, they have the polo field, which is down there, and near South 85. I think it's near Bud's Bar, down in that area, if you're familiar with Sedalia. Go ahead.
How many people did you have working on the ranch?
Well, we got to the ranch, and it was previously operated as a ranch, of course, by the Phipps family. And they had a crew. We thought, you know, let's us continue the ranching activities. Let's do the cattle operation here. We've got a lot of processing of the plan yet to do through the jurisdictions. Initial building, which was started up in Broadway and County Line Road, that was all before C-470 went through. And so we thought, okay, let's raise some cattle out here. And we ended up, I had done that in Lisa Viejo, but had the information, the great consultant, Dr. George Crenshaw, went to the University of Davis, which is the agricultural university in California, and he was our consultant. He knew ranching, he knew cattle, and he came in, he did Lisa Viejo, that's where I started with him. He came along, I had him come here, and he is the one who knew what type of the pastures we had. He knew our fencing, he knew our ranch facilities, the barns, the corrals, and all the facilities. And he got to know that right away with the ranch hands and ranch foreman. And we knew that we could do what we could do then. So we were going to have him start this ranch operation. And we conversed a lot about how big it was going to be and type thing. And we originally were going to have, I thought maybe 1,800, 2,000 head and make it a cow-calf operation, which was different than in the California program where we had a steer-stocker program, just steers, no cow-calving. And here was going to be the full-blown cow-calf operation with the facilities that already existed out there. The ranch hands knew it. So he said, let's go cow-calf, make it a real function. And we sat down, he and I talked and sketched out numbers and everything. We ended up with a program that I submitted saying, okay, here's what we're going to do. We'll do 600 a year, get 600 heifers, new heifers, first-time heifers, a year over the next 3 years, and build that up to 1,800, and it'll grow. Well, we did. We got the first. Actually, I got 200 the first year. I wanted to make sure that our fences were well maintained, well, good enough. We went through a year that we visited, too, not just the ranch foreman and ranch hands. And they ended up just implementing it, knowing the felt that felt comfortable with it. And everything worked with the first 200. We had some bulls to go with them and everything and start our cow-calf operation. And then the plan was to get another 600 the following three, each of 3 years. We did the 600 the second year, 600 the third year, young heifers. But we never implemented the third year because we were retaining then our own heifers. And they were coming out just fine. We were he would go through and select which ones we were going to keep and build into our own herd. And then the others we would take to sale. And our program was built up to the about 1,800 maybe, with the retained cows, the calves and heifers. And we would, every October, take them to the sale yard. And we enjoyed going to brush where Bob Walker had the sale yard up there. Fantastic guy. He PR'd me a lot. And I knew it being in PR. I could PR him back again to make sure we got the right time to bring the cattle and everything like that. We'd bring him up there in October and go through the sale. And it would be a sensational feeling because we wanted to always extend ourselves outside the community in addition to the activities of the citizens in the community. The Douglas County commissioners and everything, and Douglas County people. And we would take them up there, and they would have our sale, and our cattle hit top of the market. All the way down from the cows, the calves, the heifers, because he knew how to organize them into lots, sale lots to bid them on. And he did a fantastic job with them. And each Thursday, I think, was the sale or something. Friday, the newspaper would get done, and it would come out, his local little newspaper from the Livestock Exchange, and it would get distributed throughout Colorado and everything. And, of course, it got distributed to the Douglas County commissioners. Very important, I found out later, because on the backside of that newspaper was the listing of the previous Wednesday, Thursday sales. And they'd list the sales and where they were from and everything and what they got and per pound. Well, all of ours, our cows, our heifers, and everything, were always, the calves were always at the top of the list, getting the market. Douglas County commissioners would look at that and say, well, these guys, maybe they do know something about calving. I didn't tell them everything about it, but they did a great job.
So as ranch manager, I'm sure you had to have help. So did you have men to help you?
Well, I wanted to make the transition very easy, the ranching. And consequently, we had three individuals who also worked for the prior cattle operations for the FIPS. And it was Rick Toon was the foreman, ranch foreman. And the two who assisted throughout the time was
Warren Huber.
Recalculating.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay.
Cut that out.
On the cattle operations, we had a crew of three, a ranch foreman and two cowboys. The ranch foreman, they were all carryovers from the previous Phipps family operations, and they knew the pastures and farm barns and everything. So the foreman was Warren Huber, and he, with the two fellows that assisted the cowboys, were Rick Toon and David Engelhart. And they knew the property, which was very important, and they knew how to do their job. Made it very easy for a novice to come along and participate. But I always wanted to participate. I just didn't want to do the office work. I wanted to get out there. I wanted to ride with them and when the cattle go check on the cattle and how are they doing and how are the water sources? Are they good yet? The windmill's still working fine? Are the fences still being maintained? And I'd like to do that. So I'd come out and I'd want to go out in the pasture with them. And Consequently, I got my own horse rather than using one of the ranch horses. And his name was Q. He was a thoroughbred quarter horse, good combination, tall horse. Thoroughbreds are tall, and a quarter horse is probably one of the most popular horses in the United States. So it was a good breed, and we got along very well together. But I'd ride out with him. Even in the winter months, we'd go out and check on him on horseback. But a lot of times I'd go out in the non-snow period when we'd check pasture conditions and check the wells and making sure that they were all working well and his fence lines, as I indicated. So we did I enjoyed that. That was the fun part. As we talked earlier, I guess I was doing manager of community relations and had the dual position of being the ranch manager. I liked both jobs, put them both together, had fun.
Right. So you did not only the activities, ranch management, but you also were a speaker or gave presentations to many different organizations in Highlands Ranch and outside of a Highlands Ranch.
Yes. Everybody was clear enough to tell me what was going on. And the development plan, they explained, the planners explained it to me and told me in King's English how to do it and what it was. And I was talking to non-professionals as far as planners, but people that were very interested. Consequently, they were interested. They came to the events. I was surprised how many people came to events, but to learn about this new town. And I enjoyed talking.
And during when Highlands Ranch was under development, did you go to the schools to give presentations to the school?
Yeah, after the development started, I didn't stop talking. What happened was, as the community grew and the schools developed and the parks developed and everything, I would talk to school groups. I'd get invitations from third grade teachers, fifth grade teachers. And I thought, this is going to be fun. You don't have to take your big development plan down. Go to them and tell them what we're going to do. I specifically remember going to a third grade class and saying, okay, this is how I'm going to approach them on what a planned community of Highlands Ranch is. I took a piece of carpet about 10 foot square and maybe 8 foot square. And I put it on the floor in the front of the room. And I also took with me cut out squares and rectangles of wood, painted different colors, and those were going to be the buildings on Highlands Ranch that they were going to build. And I had duct tape, which was going to be the road patterns on it. And so it was so great. You'd see the children gathered in a circle around this land. Now let's start. We'd talk about how to start. Where are we going to start? Well, we got some houses and shopping centers and places to work and recreation facilities and parks, and we'll talk about all that stuff. What are we going to do? Well, let's start, let's put in a house. Before we start with a house, we need a road to get to them. Let's put in Broadway. So Broadway was the first from the north there. We brought down that tape and spread it down about half the way down. And then we said, now we got the road here. Let's put in a few more roads over here, which was Northridge, I believe, or Northridge, that area north there. And we put in some more tape for a road over there. Now, what are we going to do? What are we going to build? Well, let's have a place to live. And we built houses. So I'd hand, these are the houses over here. Let's build, and they'd take them. And they'd put some houses out. Well, it's like he wanted to put one up here, and she wanted to put one down here. And we would have been down by the mansion, the fourth home, which you don't do because you don't have your infrastructure down that far yet. And so we did it. I said, okay, good idea, but let's start thinking, bringing these, so we've got neighborhoods. Bring some of those houses back up here by this one and that one and that one. And it was up by Broadway, in the front of it. And then we said, well, we got the houses. Where are we going to get our meals? Well, we need some stores. And that was a different colored block, and we put it over there. They started to see how it's closer to the houses instead of way down on these unopened areas. And they wanted to put stuff down there right away. But they learned and how to do the schools. Oh, we've got a school here. Let's put school close to the townhomes, to the homes, so they didn't have to walk too far. And they just had, it was fun doing it. And the fifth graders, well, they were a little more progressive. They wanted to know about ranching. So I put on my vests and my chaps and the cowboy hat and went down. And I took with me a vaccination gun. They were a big handled gun that we used to doctor the cattle, calves and cattle, cows. And I told them about the process, why we did it, to keep them healthy and growing well and everything, make sure they were fed well from their mother cows. We do the mother cows as well, the bulls. And we'd use this vaccine. And that little boy up in front looked like he was pretty interested. So I'd ask him to come forward. I said, look at this. This is kind of like a gun, isn't it? Pistol. See, you got the grip here and everything. And I had it filled with water. And I'd made sure that I talked to the teacher who was standing off to the left about 10 feet away what I was going to do. And she concurred, I'm going to really excite these kids when I pull this trigger. And it's going to squirt the vaccine, the water. And it's going to be aimed to at you. And it worked. And she got the wet, the little squirt. The class wasn't sure whether to laugh or to cry or what to do, but they broke out in hysteric laughter, actually. And she did as well. It was fun. It was just a way of getting your point across. I'm sure they all remember the cattle have to be doctored. I forget how it happened, but you know, that's what they did. They probably went home and told the folks.
I'm sure they went home and informed their families about how a community is developed and how ranching is done. So in 1988, that would be kind of coming to the close of your association with Colorado, not Mission Viejo.
You're right.
Colorado. How did that come about?
It was quite a surprise. The development was going well. The activities committee was performing various activities and events throughout the community at that time. Many of the arterials were going along, shops were coming in, stores were coming in. Everything was working, just like the original development plan that I'd talked about. It was great, and it was so much fun to be a part of it and to see it happening. And it was happening the way it should have happened. Well, in 1988, they came and said, Art, guess what? They said, I don't know, what are we going to do? Got a new series coming out, got to talk to a new group. You're going to talk to me in front of a new group, but it's going to be back in California. Well, that was a big surprise. I loved Colorado so much at that time. And I still like California. Don't get me wrong, his family was there, grew up with. But I was relocated back to California. Why? In May of 1988, Mission Viejo incorporated into the city of Mission Viejo at this time. And it was a proper time for it to happen in that location. They're all communities are different. Here in Colorado, you have a metropolitan district that performs all those duties here for Highlands Ranch. They perform your park maintenance, they do your green belts, they do your snow plowing, street cleaning, and they do all of that. The metro district does. We set that up originally to do those functions. And so they said, but and now in Colorado, in California, those were all done by the county. Rather, they didn't have a metropolitan district at that time. So they incorporated, and it was a proper thing to do there. And they wanted someone to go back and just be the face, if they can do that in California, of the company. And face to whom? To the city council, to the planning commission, to the recreation commission, to the transportation and traffic commissions, to all those groups that were now city organizations. I would go to those meetings, not to speak, not to address those groups. We had our own planning staff talk to the city council and the planning commission. We had our own and talk to those various commissions. And I just went and observed, even if we weren't on the agenda, I would go to those meetings and observe. We wanted to get to know the city and have a better understanding and relationship with the city. And I guess what I would do is go to those meetings, some of them until 2 a.m. And I would go, rather than go directly home, I would go down to the company offices, get in and write out by pencil, because this was prior computer age. And I'd write out the points of interest that were interesting to the company, but didn't affect us one way directly or another or something. And I would then the next morning, and then they put that right about a dozen sheets and go put one on the president's desk, each of the vice president's desks and everything, so they kind of knew if there was a problem. But the next morning I'd get in and as I said, it was pre-computer stage, I would then dictate. What fantastic experience to dictate your notes from the previous night's activities, my transcript from my notes. And Marilyn would have those out and published by 11 o'clock, again on the desks of all those, so that they knew. It was that was my primary function to return. They wanted someone who didn't appear afraid to appear before a group, who had maybe some semblance of trying to understand what they were talking about and to communicate that back to the company. And it was fun. And then, of course, when we had our own planning items on the agenda, they'd go back and do their own, but I'd cover it very superficially and cover other points on the agenda. It was a neat experience, a way to get to know this new town all over again after 9 years. And feel I was really a part of it. I really felt a part of this new town. Today, I still go to a council meeting periodically. I know the city council people and planning commissioners. You feel a part of it, consequently, but no longer that active in the community.
Right. Well, then you retired in 1995.
Yeah, I've been retired a long time. I'm starting to think I should have retired much before then. But Mission Viejo Company was starting to scale down. And they were, at that time, looking, and of course here in Colorado, Shea was coming in at that time too. And our operations that I just described in California were being transitioned to the city. They have their own planning staffs and methods. And it was a perfect phase down. It was interesting to be a part of the initial stages of both communities. All three communities, Lisa Viejo, Mission Viejo, and of course Highlands Ranch, and then to see them phase down again. Just great opportunities, fun times. I like to share them with as many people as possible.
You had a wonderful ride.
It was a super ride.
So thinking back over your career with Mission Viejo, here, there, and everywhere, is there anything that you're most proud of that just remains in your mind as a wonderful moment?
Well, I guess you've heard me speak a lot, and you've heard me numerous people that I've spoken with and spoken to about the development activities in these three great communities. And it's just fantastic to have had the opportunity to again renew in each of these my acquaintances, having returned here to Highlands Ranch. Last night I had the great opportunity of talking to a group of the Historical Society, directly talking about the cattle operations. And to do it, whether I be talking about activities committees or just today, this oral presentation that we're doing, I'm still a part of it after those years. And it's just having that opportunity to get to know so many people and have so many opportunities to be able to share my joys and fun times with other people nowadays.
That's just wonderful. And thinking back over your career, is there anything you would have changed? Anything that you wished you had done? Or
let's do another community. but those are the days. I can say I've had the days, I've had my wonderful times. And again, I feel so fortunate for having had that opportunity.
Nothing you would change.
I don't think I'd change. I see. Today, when I came over here now, we're in a new part of the northwestern part of what was Highlands Ranch. This area was all pasture. I remember we're chasing cattle from the northeast corner up there on County Line Road and Quebec. And Quebec, yes. From that very corner, fence post, all the way across to Colorado Boulevard. And then crossing Colorado Boulevard to get them in, going back to the barn facilities. Now, we did a lot of the cattle over here in the East Ranch, the Cheese Ranch areas, and those we did over here. But those morning rise. I didn't have a dog, of course, but with like the other three ranch hands. They had their dogs. Those dogs, you've heard of sheep dogs too, and how they are. These dogs were, knew exactly how to get cattle, and if they'd see one of the herds going out, they'd run over there and nip at its heel and back. I tried to do that with some of the residents once in a while, get them back in order, but they were so wonderful. And it's so. Then last night, as I mentioned, talking to everybody, to see folks come up and say hello, Art, and just, now there were times I missed a name and I'd had to look at that name tag. Fortunately for name tags nowadays, that is so great to see these people and to come out and shake their hands again. And I want to come back, you know, do something else again, if you ask what you want to do. But I've been blessed, not only with a wonderful family, wonderful job opportunities all the way through from the college days where I met my wife, through the Navy and had fun times, best opportunities there. I mentioned I was a Supply Corps officer, and I had supply duty on board ship, got to the Orient, Japan, and the Philippines, and came back, stopped at Honolulu on the way back in Hawaii, and got to see that and came back. We now are fortunate to be able to go and to once in the spring every year for a week back to Hawaii and enjoy Honolulu areas. And then to continue on with our life the way it's been, right on the way, all the way through, and still be invited back to share memories with folks is just my pleasure. I thank you very, very, very much.
Well, we can't thank you enough. This has been a real pleasure for, I know, the residents of Highlands Ranch, for all of us, to have you come here on your own and share your memories with us and your experience, and to bring Highlands Ranch really alive in our minds of what it used to be.
Very good, very good. Because it goes through my minds very often.
I bet it does.
Thank you, Donna.
Thank you, Art.